Parental care consists of all physical and behavioral resources that parents bestow upon their offspring. In most invertebrates, these resources are limited to what the mother packs inside the eggs she lays, and which in most cases she will never see again. In other organisms, parental care can last for many years and even include university tuition fees. Not all invertebrates are such neglectful parents. For example, these dung beetles collect dung and form a ball many times their size. They lay their eggs in it, roll it to a preferred location and bury it in the ground. In some species, they even remain to guard it. The dung will feed the larvae when they hatch. You will recall that each of the parents contributes to its offspring one set of chromosomes. In addition, the mother contributes mitochondria, proteins and maternal RNA required for embryonic development. All this is packaged in an egg, the universal reproductive gizmo in all sexually reproducing creatures. The egg is indeed an amazing evolutionary invention that kept on evolving in accordance to the lifestyle of the respective organisms. Eggs that are laid in the water are generally small and water permeable. The offspring that hatch from them are usually independent. In some cases, one of the parents or both guard the eggs. Females of cichlids that live in Lake Malawi incubate their eggs in their mouth. Even after the eggs are hatched, the mother contributes to protect the young fish in her mouth for some time. Seahorses are one of the most famous cases of paternal care. The father incubates the eggs in a pouch for up to 45 days, until tiny, fully developed seahorses hatch. In some frogs, the father keeps the eggs on his back until they hatch. The need to produce water-impermeable eggs was one of the major challenges of animals when becoming fully terrestrial. This here is an Egyptian cockroach female that carries her eggs in a sack. These here are butterfly eggs. The eggs of the first fully terrestrial vertebrates, reptiles, and the birds that evolved from them have water-impermeable shells. They also contain a large amount of nutrients that support advanced embryonic development. In most reptiles, the hatchlings must fend for themselves. In some birds, the hatchlings are precocial, good to go and look for food. The parents, however, often continue to protect them, as does this nervous spur-winged lapwing. In most bird species, like these great tits, the chicks hatch blind and helpless and require intensive parental care and feeding. Female mammals have mammary glands that produce milk to feed their offspring. There are three groups of extant mammals. Monotremes are the smallest and most primitive group, with only five living species. The most famous of them is the platypus. In this group, females lay eggs and nurse the cubs that hatch from them. The second group are marsupials, with about 300 extant species, mostly in Australia and some in Southern America. In marsupials, like this kangaroo, the joys are born tiny and climb into the pouch where they attach to the nipple and suck milk. They remain in the pouch until they grow. As you see here, even when they are pretty big, they still like to seek protection in their mother's pouch. The largest and most evolved group of mammals are called placentals. These animals produce a tiny egg. After fertilization, the egg undergoes several rounds of cell division, and once it consists of about 100 cells, it implants in the uterus. It subsequently forms a placenta, through which the embryo is fed by the mother. The placenta is a temporary organ that is generated from cells of the embryo and of the mother. The embryo is connected to the placenta by the umbilical cord. There is no direct blood flow between mother and fetus. However, nutrients and oxygen pass from the mother to the fetus, and waste products and carbon dioxide are sent back. The placenta also secretes hormones that sustain the pregnancy. The placenta is expelled from the uterus after birth, and the umbilical cord is severed. Here we see a pup of a fur seal shortly after birth with its placenta still attached. The degree of neonatal pup development depends on the length of gestation and ecological adaptations. It is fascinating to see how the trade-off between the mother's capacity to feed and the safety of the offspring dictates the length of pregnancy and degree of development at birth. The pregnancy of zebras lasts a year. A newborn foals get on their legs and start walking shortly after birth. Most other herbivores on the savanna follow a similar pattern. These animals eat plants that do not run away, so that a prolonged pregnancy has little effect on the mother's capacity to feed. The long pregnancy results in a more developed offspring that has a better chance to run for its life. Predators like lions, cheetahs and leopards, on the other hand, have to chase their food at top speed, something that is difficult for a heavily pregnant female. Indeed, the gestation of these animals is only 3 months long, and their kittens are pretty helpless upon birth. In all mammals, the offspring are nursed milk by their mother, some of them for years. Milk contains proteins, fat, sugars, mainly in the form of lactose, minerals, vitamins and more. Immediately after birth, the milk contains also antibodies that protect the newborn animal from diseases while it develops its own immune system. We are watching here lactation by various animals we filmed in Africa. Lactation is a reproductive behavior that is easiest to watch, as most other reproductive behaviors are short-term and restricted to certain seasons. Lactation, in contrast, lasts for many months and in some animals even years. We will conclude this video by briefly mentioning reproductive strategies. For long-term survival of a species, the number of individuals that survive to a reproductive age has to be maintained from one generation to the next. Considerable fluctuations due to environmental changes are of course very common. Many organisms, like corals or surgeonfish, produce a huge amount of offspring. These are released into the harsh environment without any care or protection. Obviously, only a tiny fraction of these will survive to reproduce themselves. This strategy of mass reproduction with little individual investment is often called R strategy. At the other end of the scale, we find animals like elephants that produce only a single offspring every few years and take care of it for many years. Subsequently, 3 out of every 4 elephants reach sexual maturity. Such a strategy of few offspring with high investment is often called K strategy. All other animals are somewhere in the spectrum between R and K.